especially today's word. It's a Palm Sunday. Today is the beginning of our God's special event. He is, all of us is in his mind, bring us back to the Garden of Eden, isn't it? Yeah, but then we should have faith to believe that. It's just like switching the light. Just I was reading something that if you use your hand to switch the light, but you use your faith to see through it.
Yes.
See, that's how it is. Without the faith, you cannot see what's in it. What's really the spirit in the spirit realm.
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. I'm going to read again this word for us by Sister Carolyn. This is good. This is the King. We celebrate the King of Kings.
Yes.
Praise God. Come sing praises to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, your Lord. Come sing praises to him for all that he has done for you, for all he has promised you that you now walk in, and sing praises for, and dance. Dance light on your feet, my children. Come together and dance and rejoice. Open your heart, and let your rejoicing flow freely from your heart. We delight in the praises of our people. We delight in you, as you delight in us. We are one. Come celebrate. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Okay, if you're ready to praise God and worship him, let's go stand up and go for it.
Speak to the north and the south. We tell you now, give them up, all your nation. In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Right now should be your time.
Glory.
Thank you.
strength will rise as we wait. Yeah. going on. There's someone bigger than me. There's something big going on. Holy, holy. There's something big going on. There's someone bigger than me. There's something big going on. Holy, holy.
Round the throne, take
give it all to you, Lord.
Round the throne, take From you be all glory. Show us your glory, Father. We want to see your glory, Father. Not satisfied where we're at, Lord. We know there's more, God. We're hungry for the glory, God. Hallelujah!
Round the road,
Show us your glory, Father.
lost in your eyes.
Desperate for more of you, Lord.
Yeah.
so thankful for your presence, Father God. Thank you for your glory. Hallelujah. We reverence your presence, Father. Love your presence, Father God. Wash over us with your glory this morning, Father. Hallelujah.
Well, the Lord is good.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Lord. Wow. Thank you, Father. We just magnify you today. We bless your holy name. We give you honor. We give you glory. Kathy, would you go up to the floor? Lord, we worship you today. We magnify you in this place. We're here because of you. We're here because you said to us not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. So we're just obeying your word. There's a reason that you said to do that. You said there were those that had already started forsaking the assembling together. You said there would be those that would. But you told us not to do that. There's a reason that we gather. It's not to glorify an individual, a person, a human. It's to glorify you, Lord.
Yes,
magnify
Lord.
Magnify the Lord.
You alone,
sing praises
your word,
unto
Jesus.
His name. Praise his name and pray to glorify him.
Yes.
Lord, as we were singing this morning about your glory, Father, we do desire to see it. We've had little glimpses of it, little touches of it. Lord, there's so much more than we've ever dreamed.
Yes, there is.
So very much more. Father, we desire more of the glory.
Yes.
Because we're hungry for it.
Yes.
We want to experience. Lord, the Israelites in the wilderness certainly experienced your glory. When they dedicated the temple in Jerusalem, they experienced your glory. John said that they saw the glory of God. Peter, James, and John experienced the glory upon the Mount of Transfiguration. Lord, there is a glory. It says of Jesus, he's the King of glory.
The consuming fire.
He dwells in the realm of glory.
Yes.
Lord, there's times that you just let the glory of heaven into a building, into a place. We do desire that, Lord.
Come in, King of Glory.
We can't make you do it. But Lord, we just want you to know that we would love that.
Come, Jesus. We need a touch.
Thank you, Lord. You brought over
an element where there's glory that just comes in and you don't have to make any effort. And then there's also a way that you can step into the glory by faith. See, when Moses went up in the mountain the first time, I think 70 elders and a whole bunch of people, Aaron went with him, and I don't know if Aaron went with him, but I know that 70 elders went with him. If I'm wrong, correct me. So a lot of people went the first time. The second time around, only Moses went. You know, they were all hungry the first time, but the second time was a little harder, and only Moses went up. But there was still, he had to step into that cloud. He had to step into that cloud by faith. He had to go into that glory. And so, yes, there's an element where the glory can come in here, and it's awesome, and it's powerful, it's wonderful. But then there's the other side where we can also all step in by faith, and step into that glory, and step into that supernatural place where God does these supernatural things. And again, we may not know the full implication, but you know, he said it's in the vision is the provision. And when you step into the cloud, it's like stepping into a vision. It's like stepping into something supernatural. And that's where God makes a provision. So whether we see that provision right away today, or you feel it right away today, there's still a provision being made. So I believe we can all go deeper this morning. You know, it's like you say, don't try to figure it out with your natural mind. Like trying to speak in tongues, you don't figure it out with your mind. You just do it by faith. You do it. And so by faith, step into that cloud this morning. And just step into what God has for each and every one of us today.
It's in the glory.
You know, when Moses came down after 40 days and 40 nights, he said that he'd been in the glory, and it just changed him. And in fact, it was shining so brightly through him that it frightened the Hebrews, and they had to told him, put a mask over your face. Imagine that. You know, put a mask over your face. You can't handle this. See, sometimes the glory is can be a lot different than we think it is. But in the epistles it says that there's a greater glory that we're in. There's a greater glory that you and I walk in that's available to us. Hallelujah. And like Pastor Daly said, it has to do with faith. Hallelujah. There's a glory that's already in here. Now, how many believe there's some angels in here this morning? Well, most of us haven't seen them yet, but we still believe. You're going to have to believe that the glory's in here, too. Just fact, we believe the angels are in here because the Word of God says so. Well, the Word of God says His glory is in here too. Hallelujah. Thank you, Miss Cassie. You're awesome this morning. Your mask matches your blouse there. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Now let's pray a little bit. Rome did not go to the Catar of the Bible. Gita de la Vida, Citarana, Moscara, Motara. Citara, go to the Catar of the Catarama, the Bota, Estara. Ashibore, the Catarama, Sumpone, the Sambar, the Catar of the Bota. Have you had something that's going on? Are you sure? Did you check deep or are you just checking your head? Hallelujah. From David Shikamba, Rosh Bibushe. Ah, we worship you, Lord. Lord, we worship you this morning. You are so worthy. You are so worthy. Thank you, Lord. Now, Kemp was sharing with me before the service started. He said they've gone to, what's the name of the church? Eastgate?
Eastgate House of Prayer in Quispam.
Yeah, and one of the ladies there had a prophetic word about the glory, you know, just being dialed up, and that then it really fell in that place too, and it really it touched the young people, touched everybody that was there, and he said there were bodies all over the floor. That's one of the can be one of the manifestations of the glory, and so you know, it does happen. We're not asking God to duplicate what he did there, but then we're not against it either.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So, glory, glory, glory. Well, how many of you know what day today is? It's Palm Sunday. And that is a time that it's part of the passion of the Christ as he is going into his last week, that his earthly ministry in the flesh was here. And so it's a very significant time for the church, a significant time for you and me to remember what he did and the price that he paid. And so if you want to turn with me, go into the Gospel of Luke. We're going to go there this morning for a little bit. The Gospel of Luke. Okay, where is that? Thank you, Lord. Luke 19, verse 28. And when he had thus spoken, he went before ascending up to Jerusalem. Notice that part, ascending up to Jerusalem. The Bible in different places says, let us go up. Let us go up to Jerusalem. Jerusalem was a place of elevation. It was a little bit higher than many of the other places. But it's symbolic of, God is up. Devil is down, God is up. The things of God are always up.
Amen.
The things of God are always up. And so Jesus, he said he started going up. He was ascending up, going to Jerusalem. Jerusalem, of course, means the place of peace, the city of peace. And it seems strange that the name Jerusalem would be called the city of peace. When there is so little peace that's been there, such a contentious place even today, but yet the time will come that it will truly be that, because the Lord will come down, and when he comes back again the second time as Lord, Savior, King, and the Lion of Judah, he'll put his foot down on the Mount of Olives, and it's going to split wide open, and it will be that peace that is a prophesied to totally be. And it says, and it came to pass, when he was come nigh to Bethpage and Bethany at the mount called Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples, saying, go into the village over against you, in the which at your entering you shall find a colt tied, whereon yet never man sat. Loose him and bring him hither. You know, the story of it's called the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. It's mentioned in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And so many of the things that Jesus did are not recorded in all four, but in this particular case, this story, this event is recorded in there. So that, and each one records it, you know, it adds a little bit more detail. And so you have to actually read all four different accounts of it to get the full detail of it all. We won't do that this morning, but it said go over into the village over against you, in which entering you'll find a colt tied wherein never a man sat. And bring him hither, and if any man asks you, why do you do this? Loose him in, and let me read it right, I'm getting it all mixed up here. And if any man asks you, why do you loose him? Thus you shall say to him, because the Lord has need of him. Now this is prophetic. If you want to turn to Zechariah 9:9. This coming into Jerusalem is a prophetic event that had been prophesied many hundreds and hundreds of years in advance before it happened. And it says here in Zechariah 9:9, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion, and shout, O daughter of Jerusalem, behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly, and riding upon an ass, and upon the colt of the foal of an ass. And so Zechariah has prophesied hundreds and hundreds of years before this ever happened, that this would happen when the Messiah would come. This would be one of the events that would happen. And so, but people say, well, you know, did Jesus already know that there would be a colt there? Yes, he did. Why? Because he knew the scriptures. He knew what Zechariah 9:9 said. And so people say, well, see, that's not very supernatural if Jesus already knew what the scriptures said. Yeah, but he didn't tell him where that donkey was located. He didn't tell him where it was at. He just said, Zechariah doesn't say, you know, he says he's just going to come riding upon a donkey. And so the Holy Spirit has to show Jesus, has to either tell him or show him where that donkey is at. Now, here's another thing. I don't know. I spent a lot of years in Oklahoma and in Arkansas pastoring. And one of the things I did find out was if you have a horse or a donkey that's never been sat on, they like to buck. They like to buck. And yet it says that nobody had ever sat on this colt. So it couldn't have been a real little one, but it was one that had never been, anybody ever sat on it. And it didn't say a word about him bucking Jesus off. So that had to be supernatural right there. Okay? Fine, he's the Prince of Peace. Hallelujah. And so as they go, they find the colt. The guy says to him, why are you doing this? And they said, well, the master has need of him. Verse 32, and when they had went unto their way, found him even as he had said unto them. And as they were loosening the colt, the owner thereof said to him, why are you loosening the colt? And he said, the Lord has need of him. See, here was a seemingly small detail. You know, here's a man, we're only told that he was the owner of the colt. And yet somewhere he's alluded to in Zechariah 9:9. Somehow he's included in that prophecy, even though he's not mentioned, but he's alluded to, because Jesus doesn't have a stable of horses and donkeys. So somebody has to have them. And the disciples, he said to tell the man, Jesus said, tell the man, the Lord has need of him. Do you understand that the Lord has need of you? Mm-hmm. Now, you might not think, you know, I'm sure that guy that had raised the donkey and everything, he never had thought too much into how important he would be in the plan of the Messiah coming into Jerusalem. Probably gave it little to no thought at all. Probably wondering, what am I doing? Why am I raising donkeys and things like that? Doesn't seem like, you know, maybe business hasn't been very good or whatever. But when the word came, the Lord has need. Do you know God has needs? The Lord has needs. And he has needs that something that only you can actually fulfill and can only do. Because if you don't get it done, it might not be done. And so the Lord needs you. Say, the Lord needs me.
The Lord needs me.
Say it again, the Lord needs
me. The Lord needs me.
Doesn't that help him feel a little bit better?
Yeah.
You say, but I don't know what he wants me to do. Don't worry about it. He'll tell you when it's time. He'll tell you when it's time. You know, there's a scripture that just talks about an old disciple. An old disciple. They said we lodged with one, an old disciple. Well, at least he got in the Bible. It doesn't mention, I don't think it mentioned his name, just calls him an old disciple. So some of us qualify.
Yep.
Hallelujah. I don't know, I've been saved. I'm trying to figure that one out. A long time. Maybe I could qualify as the old disciple. I'm not as old as Rob, but I might qualify. Hallelujah. But the Lord has need of what you have. You say, well, I don't have anything. Yeah, but the thing you don't think you have is the thing he probably needs the most.
Yep.
Do you have a voice? Sometimes he needs your voice. You know, sometimes the other day, I was coming back, I was going home, and just had left the church, and it was really windy. It was really cold. And it was just blowing a gale out there. And I mean, I just hated to go out to the car. And while I was driving down the road here, there was this lady was out there hitchhiking. I don't know about you, but I don't normally pick up hitchhikers at all. But I could just see she was a lady, a little bit older lady. And it was so cool. I pulled over and I picked her up. And and I told my wife all about this, so it's not news to her. And I thought she's got to be brave to be out there in this day and age, you know, because you don't know who you're going to get in a car with. And so I told her I was a Christian and I pastored a church down the road. And she didn't seem to know that we were down here, but she lived in one of the little subdivisions here, and she was going to Jean Couteau. And so we just visiting back and forth a little bit, and I just told her, you know, well, I pastored the church. I just wanted her to, you know, maybe feel at ease or something, that I wasn't a masher or anything like that. I was just a pastor. And so she had quite a French accent too, and I was pastor. She just started talking. She was from France. And so I had heard through different people that the French that the people in Canada speak is not like the French in France that they speak. And I asked her, I said, well, is that so? And she said, oh yeah, that's true. She says the French that they speak here is considerably different than the French they speak there. And sometimes she has trouble understanding it. So we were just visiting about that. So we got to Jean Couteau when she was getting out. And my heart just really went out to her, and because she had a long, I wasn't going to wait, because I don't know how long, you know, women can shop, it's long enough, I wait for my wife, and she goes shopping, and it can be a long wait sometimes, and she's hurrying too, and so, anyway, so I was going to go on home, but as she was getting out, I reached her, and I gave her $20, and I said, why don't you take this and get yourself a taxi so you don't have to come back?
Not sure.
She just broke down. She started crying. Crying. Now this is going to sound strange, okay? But she reached over her hand on my chest and she says, is there anything I can do for you? Well, I just said, no, there's nothing you can do for me. Absolutely nothing. And I said, don't do
Oh, man.
But I think she was innocent. I knew it. It just, it was after I was driving home, I thought, that's why I told her I was innocent.
Oh, man.
But then, I know, she just broke down, she cried. You know, that's somebody, she just said, God bless you. I said, he does, he does.
Yeah.
And so, you know, there's a little something, I could give a ride to somebody on a really cold and windy day.
Awesome.
Now, will she ever come to church? I don't know. But, you know, you can touch somebody's life sometimes, just a little something.
Yep.
And make all the difference in the world. And just the thought, or just a word. See, all of us have something. You know, there could be somebody here today that you're going through something discouraging, or you're going through a challenge or difficult time. But sometimes just a hug, just a word of encouragement. You know, sometimes you just feel led to, you know, just be a blessing to somebody. This is, you know, makes all the difference in the world sometimes. Because we've had people that will give us money to give to somebody else. And we've just recently done that, and then that person, when I let them know that somebody had thought of it, they just broke down and cried. That somebody thought that. Nobody ever thinks of me, but somebody did. And it was a blessing to them. It says, the Lord has need of you. Even today, the Lord has need of you. There's something you can do. You know, there's times we just need someone to come up and play quietly, you know, like we do when we're ministering. That's it. That's, you know, the Lord has need of that. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you think, well, that's no big deal. Well, maybe it might not be a big deal to you, but it might be a big deal to God.
Yeah.
That'd be a big deal to God. Just being a blessing to somebody could be a real big deal to God. I remember Kenneth Hagin shared this story, and a number of years ago, he'd been traveling extensively, and the Lord had told him to give some particular minister or somebody $10. And you know, back in years and years ago, that was a tremendous amount of money. It was $10 or $50. It wasn't very much. But he was saying, Lord, you know, I need that. And he said, I want you to give that to him. So he obeyed and did that. And he said some time later, I don't know, some weeks later, some months later, he said, I was sleeping in bed. And suddenly, he said, at 3 in the morning, he said, I sat bolt upright in bed. He says, I knew my son was in danger. His life was in danger. He said, I just knew it. And his son was in the army, and he was in South Korea at the time. And the Lord spoke to him and said, because you obeyed me, I spared your son's life today. At that very moment, he had been up on a dirt bike up in the mountain, just dirt bike, and he had lost control, and he started to go over a cliff. And it stopped him from going over. Now see, we don't think that those little things mean very much. You know, maybe it's more of an inconvenience to us to give something or to do something like that. But see, that's no small thing with God. You know, when he didn't have to do a funeral. Okay. Just simply because they obeyed. He obeyed. Hallelujah. And so the Lord might ask you to do something, you know, sometime this week, be a blessing to somebody, or share something. I remember when I was going to Bible school, a lady, she gave this testimony. And she said down the street was seemed to be a very wealthy couple, and they seemed like they had everything. They had a beautiful home, a beautiful yard, nice cars. And the Lord said to her, I want you to make some soup and take some soup down to them. And she was arguing with the Lord. She said, they're the ones I'll be bringing me something. They're the ones that got all the money. It's a hard time. Things are tough for us. She said, I want you to make some soup for them. Take some soup down there. She's arguing with the Lord about it. And you know, it doesn't make sense. Make them some soup. And but she went and finally she obeyed. And she took some soup down there, knocked on the door. Said, I felt like the Lord told me to bring this to you. And the lady of the house, she opened up the door. And she saw the soup and she just broke down and began to cry. She said, we didn't have anything to eat. We just had absolutely nothing. We were just going through a real tough time. We've lost basically everything. And so just that little something helps. Hallelujah. I had a Tim Tracy, he would write the Bible school with me. You got time for a story?
Yes, we do, yeah.
He would write with me to Bible school. And in Bible school students, it can be really tough sometimes. And so he was saying, Lord, I need a pair of socks. And, you know, socks aren't really expensive, but if you don't have money for socks, you know, it might be like gold. He said, Lord, I don't have any money for socks. I need some socks. I need some socks. And he said it wasn't about a week later, somebody came and knocked on the door and said, I feel so stupid. I feel so absolutely stupid. I said, just forgive me, but I had to do this, and I just had to hand him a pair of socks.
Oh my gosh.
That's how it works.
Awesome.
See, sometimes it's just the littlest things. The Lord has need of them. The Lord, see, there's something that God can use you in either today or tonight or tomorrow or this week. If you just be listening, you know, if you just listen, you could there'll be something that you can do that would be a blessing to somebody. You know, maybe it saved their life. Maybe it turned a hopeless gray day into a bright sunny day for them. Here's a man, all he's got is donkeys. And I like the story that Pastor Nelly talks about the donkeys. With all the people and all the adoration and all the palms and everything that they're laying before. And you know, the donkey gets to thinking he's pretty, must be pretty hot stuff. They're doing it all for me. Well, it's really not about you and I. It's just about being the Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. And if any man asks you, why do you listen, thus you say, and then because the Lord has need of you. The Lord has needs. He needs somebody to do some things. Say, well, can't he do it himself?
There I am, Lord.
Well,
use me.
Maybe he could, but God at times prefers to use people. If we find out how obedient we are. I like to. You have time for another story?
Yeah.
I've shared it before, but it's a good story. In my early Christian years, I'd been saved a little bit. The Lord's trying to teach me about obedience, to trust him and to do what he would say to do. And there was a gentleman there. The Lord said to me at the resort, it was early in the spring, during the spring fishing. The Lord said to me, go up and say, praise the Lord to him. I thought, what? I was always concerned the Lord would ask me to get on a bus. And then start preaching in the front of the bus to all the people. I kept thinking, dear Lord, don't ever get on a bus. I had this thing about preaching in front of a lot of people. I don't know. But anyway, the Lord said, go say praise the Lord to him. I said, Lord, I can't do that. I said, I want you to go say praise the Lord to him. And so I argued with the Lord about it, and I said, well, okay, tomorrow, I'll do it tomorrow. So I get up tomorrow fully intending to do it. And the guy's gone. I said to my dad, I said, what happened to so-and-so? He said, oh, he had to leave early this morning. He had to go back home. And then I felt, you know, I felt like an ache-sucking dog then. I mean, just terrible. Well, I had disobeyed God. And I had done what he told me to do, and I failed. And I'm moping and, you know, whining and crying to the Lord, I'm sorry if you'll ever give me another chance, you know, I'll do it. And so a couple days later, I'm up early, I'm down at the dock working, and this boat pulls up to the dock, and it's the same guy again. He had gone home for a couple days and turned around and came back. I didn't know he was back. And he pulled up to the dock, and I thought, this is it, I'm going to do it. And I said, well, I better just kind of ease into this. I don't want to shock you too much. I said, were the fish biting? And he holds up a finger as a stretch. I said, well, praise the Lord. He said, praise the Lord to me. He said, are you a Christian? I said, yeah. I said, are you a Christian? Yeah. Turns out he's spirit-filled, I'm spirit-filled. Oh, we had a most marvelous time.
Yeah.
But see, God was trying to teach me. But it seems some of the times the silliest things. Let's just say praise the Lord. Just say praise the Lord. Got time for another story?
Yeah.
There was a man at Bible school. He was the dean at one time. His last name was Moffat. And before he became a Christian, he was the mayor of a small town in Mississippi. And he went to a denominational liturgical church. And even though he was on the board there, an elder or something there, he wasn't saved. He wasn't, you know, they didn't necessarily believe in any of that. And so they had, somehow they had invited some singers in from Christ for the Nations, because they were going through on their bus and looking for places to sing. And so the church was opened up to them, and they were going to have a concert that day. And the kids were coming by, shaking hands, coming into the building, or leaving one or the other, but they were shaking hands with everybody in the sky. Moffat, he's there shaking hands. And one of the teenagers looked right now and said, "Jesus is Lord!" Shook his hand, moved on. He said, "That so pierced me." He said that those three words, "Jesus is Lord," he said, just pierced my heart. And he said that was the catalyst that drove me to find the Lord and get saved and become a minister.
Amen.
I had a man walk up to me, I'm 14 years old. Yeah, you know what I mean. I'm 14 years old. I'm at the resort. I'm working. I'm getting ready to go over to where they do the horseshoes, because every morning I have to go over and straighten everything up, make sure I find all the horseshoes, make sure they're all there. And I'm standing there with the shovel, and I can show you the almost exact spot. A guy walks up to me, and he said, "Yeah, you ever thought about going into the ministry, being a pastor?" And I said, "Ha, ha, 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 not me." But he planted a seed that went so deep. I ran for 20 years with that seed in me. 20 years I ran from that. I couldn't shake it. Those few words, that he said, but the Lord had need of him to plant a seed in me.
Yeah.
Do you know you can say something that can change somebody's life? I don't know who that man was, but in heaven I'll get to thank him. You thank him too, because if he hadn't done that, we wouldn't be here today.
Oh, amen.
See, you can say something to somebody. And sometimes we don't think that, you know, I'm sure when he said that to me, he didn't know what he did. He didn't know the implications of all the ramifications of everything that he said. Those few words. But the Lord had need of it. The Lord has need of you. Maybe you don't feel like he does. Maybe you feel like you're God, I don't think God could ever use me, but he can. Well, I don't have $1 million to give. He doesn't need you to give $1 million. He might just need you to say Jesus is Lord to somebody. God will make a way for you. Maybe it's to make some soup or sticky buns. I mean, whatever. God could do work through sticky buns. He could work through cinnamon buns. You know, God works in mysterious ways.
Uh-huh.
Hallelujah. I was listening to Nancy Dufresne, and she was saying how she loved to eat bread. It's just, you know, and she was a picky eater. Her and her dad were both picky eaters when she was little. And so bread was a staple part of their diet. And so she says, because we were so fussy, sometimes we just have great gravy. She said we always had to have gravy. My mom cooked gravy too. My mom could make gravy out of hot dogs. It didn't make any difference. She made the best gravy all the time. And so I've always liked gravy. So I could connect with her story. And she was talking about how she just loved bread, and she could always eat it. She said now she's growing up and she's ministering in a town, and they have the pastor have to take her back to her hotel, motel or something. They always have to go by the Krispy Kreme donut shop. Okay? And she said it always worked out that red light was on, and when that light is on, it means they've just come off the, they're still hot.
Oh,
and
boy.
They're still hot. And they put the light on so everybody knows you can come in. And she said, we'd have to do that every time. She said, it was always on. But we'd drive by, so we'd always have to stop. And we'd have to Yeah, she said, I'd have to get me a couple Krispy Kreme donuts. And she says, I feel so bad about it, you know, that here I am. She says, I love these things. You know, she says, has anybody ever had a Krispy Kreme besides me? Am I telling the truth? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, it's like, you talk about the glory. This is close. This is close. He, but the pastor said, you know, some time ago, he said, we had Brother Hagin here. And we had to drive by the same Krispy Kreme, and he'd make me stop in there. He'd get some milk. He said, then the pastor, he'd get a dozen for himself, and Kenneth Hagin would get a dozen for himself, set in the car, and he'd eat every night. Brother Hagin eat a dozen Krispy Kreme donuts and wash it down with milk.
Oh, my God.
Wow. So what's that got to do with your sermon? Nothing. Absolutely nothing.
It's just another story.
Wow.
But you know what? Even, you know, Krispy Kremes could be a blessing to somebody. I think we need to pray in a story here. Hallelujah.
Wow.
Say to him, the Lord has need of him.
The Lord has need of you.
Lord has need of you. You know, sometimes, you know, years ago, if you would have asked me that I like flags, I would have said no. In my early church, I probably would have frowned on it quite a bit, but you grow up and mature. And so I got a phone call one day, I won't tell you from who, but another pastor in another town. And he said, I see your videos on Facebook all the time, and you got people flagging and everything, and he mentioned a very, very, very well-known minister in the world, and he said to me, he says, you know, Reverend so-and-so, Pastor so-and-so, says that flags actually take away the anointing, and so if you have flags in your service, there is no anointing, and he said, is that true? And I said, well, if you would be honest with you, I have found it probably increases the anointing. Mm-hmm. I said it probably increases the anointing. I've never found that the flags have caused grieved the Spirit of God. He said, can you give me chapter and verse for that? I'm thinking, dear Lord, where would that be? And the Lord reminded me of Jesus coming into the city of Jerusalem, it says, and they broke off palms. Why did they call them palms? Because they looked like a hand, a palm hand, and they waved them. He said, enough said. Enough said. He says, I'm going to have them in my church now.
Wow.
We'll be going in a few weeks to find out. Hallelujah.
Well,
wow. There are things that can quench the spirit, you know. And I guess, you know, there could be times that flags could be out of order. There's just sometimes speaking can be out of order. So there's times it's in order, but then there's times that you have to be led by the Spirit for whatever we do. There is a leading of the Spirit that needs to be done. There's an anointing to do some things. There's times that the anointing, you know, can be on the flag and the flagging, and it can bring great liberty and great freedom. There can be times that just our praise and shouting, as I know Kemp is a great shouter. Mm-hmm. And there can be times that shout can just set somebody free. But, you know, you shout at the wrong time. I was in a service one time with Brother Hagin, and he was teaching us about clapping. Let's give the Lord a hand. Come on, everybody, come. Let's give the Lord a hand. Well, did you know there's only one scripture that talks about clapping to the Lord? One. Now, there's other scriptures about the trees clap their hands and everything. There's only one. But they made that into a major thing. And the Lord, had appeared to him, he said, teach the people that clapping is for humans. It's for sports figures. It's for presidents and things like that.
He says, what you do with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is you raise your hands and you worship Him.
Hallelujah.
And he's teaching on this, and he gives an utterance, and right in the middle of his utterance, somebody clapped her hand, and she didn't even hear. Didn't even hear what was being said. And so there's times I've been in multitudes of services, you have too, and they'll say, let's give the Lord a clap offering.
Yeah.
I just raised my hand. Yeah. I just raised my hand. Now, like Brother Hicks said, it's all right to clap to the music, to clap to the beat. That's fine. Okay? But see, clapping, he says, will grieve the Spirit of God. He said, Brother Hicks said, I have been in service where the Spirit was moving powerfully. People get the clapping. And it would grieve the Spirit of God. Grieve the Spirit of God. I don't know why we're getting off on this today.
That's interesting.
But it would grieve. There's things that we can do one time and it'll enhance it. And there's times the next time it can grieve the Spirit of God. Why? Because you know we're not following the Spirit. We're following the flesh. We can be in the Spirit one minute and then the flesh the next. Mm. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Well, praise the Lord. The Lord is good, isn't he?
Amen.
The Lord said something. Do you ever have a moment? I'll just share with you what the Spirit had said to me this morning. And it was quite simple. I was thinking about Romans 8:14, for as many as are led of the Spirit, they're the children of God. And so I was thinking, I believe it was the Lord, said, as you follow him, the gifts will follow you.
Oh, boy.
Now, think about this. As you follow the Spirit, the gifts will follow you.
Wow.
As you follow him, we're to follow the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
But as we follow the Holy Spirit, the gifts will follow you. It says over in Mark 16, and God confirmed the word. The signs followed.
Mm.
Hallelujah. Oh, I threw that in for free.
That's good.
Glory, glory, glory. And so, as we get into a place that we get more obedient to the Spirit of God, we get more conscious of those little things. It's those little things that can make all the difference in the world. Sometimes it can be a shout that just sets everybody free. We've seen that happen. Just all of a sudden somebody gets anointed to run and they take off and just the glory comes.
Yeah.
And then you see other people running in the flesh. We had they asked me one time in my second church if they wanted to, Kenneth Hagin Ministries wanted to know, can we come down to your church and bring a tent and just kind of get back to the good old days of the old-fashioned tent meetings. And we had quite a bit of acreage, and so I said, sure, come on, bring your tent down. And so they got the tent up, and it would seat a couple hundred, and they had the music. It was in the summertime and singing. And one of the Ramah singers jumped off the platform and took off a running. And he ran smack into a pole, split his head wide open, bleeding all over the place. You say, well, how did God do something like that? God didn't have anything to do with that. He just took off in the flesh. Just took off in the flesh.
Oh, man.
You see, running, it has to be by the Spirit of God. Because it'll produce something. How do we get off on all this stuff? But if we just learn to listen to the Spirit of God, He will lead us. When He leads us, the manifestations will follow as He wills. But it has to be the Spirit. And so we need to get very well acquainted. We're all really well acquainted with our flesh.
Yeah.
Okay? But we need to get very well acquainted with the Holy Spirit.
Yes, we do.
Because the Holy Spirit will anoint us, and He'll guide us,
yep.
And He wants to use you, but He wants to use you His way. You don't say, God, I'll do this for you. Well, you let Him tell you what He wants you to do.
Mm-hmm.
And then I everything he's ever asked me to do is always uncomfortable. I always feel like, well, I'll feel like an idiot if this don't work. I'll feel like an idiot.
Yeah.
Well, Paul said he was willing to be made a fool for Christ. Being willing to be made a fool. But God chooses the weak and the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, like if we qualify. Amen?
Oh, yeah.
So God wants to use you today. Jesus was coming into the time of the crucifixion within a week. But it's these little things. He was coming into the greatest move that the earth has ever seen at that time. And he had nobody thought he was doing the right thing. Everybody thought he was wrong. But he had to do. I remember Lester Sumrall said this. Most people do what's good. Few people do what's best. God only does what's best for us. He doesn't do what's good for us. He does what's best for us. Can you remember that today? Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Well, I didn't get very far into our message today, but it is what it is. Hallelujah. How many know what time it is now? Offering time. Rob, are you able to do the offering this morning? Thanks. Don't forget, in your bulletin, there's all kinds of information in there. How many ever read your bulletin? I mean, put your hand. I mean, if you honestly ever read your bulletin. All six of you. Okay. No, that's not one. In your bulletin is a lot of information that we don't get to. And something that I felt like the Lord had said to me was, with the building of the new building, it's going to be many millions of dollars, and there's going to be people that are going to have a little trouble wrapping their head around how many millions of dollars it's going to take. And I felt like the Lord said, well, ask them to believe God for just a million. First million, they'll get some dirt work done. Yeah? How many, do you think it's easier to believe for a million than five or six? Thank you, Carolyn. But join your faith. Believe with us. The money is there. The money is out there. And it's on its way. So believe with us, because it'll come. It'll come. It'll manifest. Yep. All we have to do is believe for the impossible. Okay? Thank you, Rob.
Simply believe.
I guess we get this thing all fired up and ready to go. Anyway. One of the things that Kathy and I had written, especially maybe learned, Kathy may have known, and I just took me a while to catch on. But years ago, we started tithing. And we were doing the best we could. We were trying as hard as we could. And some days we were pretty good, and some days it just didn't quite work out so good. And anyways, we just kept at it, and kept putting the tithe in. Every once in a while, I think to myself, this really isn't working. This really sucks, because here we are putting this money in, and it just doesn't seem to be any effect whatsoever. And then it dawned on me one day, be thankful for what you got.
Amen.
Maybe you'll get some more.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
So I started being thankful for the old car that didn't work quite well, but at least it got us back and forth. It wasn't real pretty. I've got a tractor at the house I call Mr. Tractor. It came from my father-in-law. It was a hand-me-down. It's cost me more heart, more grief than you can imagine. You tell, ask Kathy about this old tractor I've got out of the house. And every time there was a little storm, the thing would work just like a churn. Let there be 2 feet of snow, the stupid thing wouldn't start. I made a habit of every time I went out to that old tractor, I'd say, thank you, Lord, for this old tractor.
Yeah.
And if it didn't start, I'd say, thank you, Lord, for the shovel, but I still got the tractor. We'll just fix what's broke on it. This last winter, it never missed a beat.
Awesome.
I've done a little bit here, a little bit there to it, and tinkered away at it, and fretted away at it. And what really made me appreciate the old tractors when I went and priced a new one. It's amazing how much I like that old tractor. But the point of all of this is, if we're thankful for what we've got, God will give us increase.
Amen.
But if you're a spoiled brat and you're not thankful for what he's already given you, you might just have what you got and that might be it. You know, even if we are, he'll keep his word. He will give the increase that he has promised. But the increase is tenfold, 50-fold, 100-fold. And if we want the 100-fold, we have to be thankful for the 10-fold.
Yeah.
And it will increase.
Yes.
You know. And even Kat and I, every day isn't roses. Some days, like I get laid off in the winter, and some days we're looking at each other with the finances thinking, you know, well, we got to just try tighten the belt a little bit here. But it always comes around.
Amen.
It always comes around. So, if you're faithful with a little, God can trust you with a lot, right?
Yeah.
Anyway, that's enough rambling. If you want an envelope, raise your hands. The nice young ladies will give you an envelope. And let's say something as we always do. Lord God, I am so grateful.
I am so
thankful for what you have given me. And I appreciate it with
my whole heart.
Amen. So you got church Sunday night, Tuesday night is a prayer meeting, or prayer time, and I'm quite sure that everyone who is here, all five or six of them, would appreciate seeing 30 or 40 of you here, because where three or four are gathered, God is there, but when there's 40 of you, it's that much stronger.
Oh, yeah.
Amen? So Wednesday night is the regular Bible study. Friday night is miracle night, and it's also Good Friday. So there you go.
Cool.
God bless you, watch over, keep you, and protect you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.